So welcome, everyone. Glad you could come out tonight. The course, or the lecture title is tonight is the Introduction to Liturgical Books. So this is a very broad topic. A couple of things that it is not going to be. It's not going to be an introduction to liturgical music, even though that's what I normally teach at the seminary, being the choir director. We're not going to talk about chanting, anything like this. We're going to talk about the books that our liturgical texts come from. So liturgical books, as opposed to chant books. The books that you see in front of you are all texts. They're not music books. And we're also going to talk about basically giving you a very solid foundation by which to continue your studies later on. So this course, it's a two-part course, this week and then a week later in March, a few weeks from now. I'm not going to sort of give you a crash course on everything that you would need to know to become a choir director in a matter of 30 minutes. The way that I view the subject is that it's such an important subject, it's worthy of laying the right foundation, starting with the most basic understanding of how all of this fits together, as opposed to kind of giving you piecemeal bits of knowledge that you might that might help you in a if you're caught in a bind to have to do Vespers sort of very quickly. But I'm going to give you the kind of big view of things. So the first thing that we need to discuss is, in brief, kind of a spiritual understanding of the importance of this topic. The divine services of the church are the greatest treasure of the church. And the reason that they're the greatest treasure of the church is because the services are what most perfectly and most fully represents for us what our activity is going to be in the kingdom of heaven. So, since we pray constantly for our salvation, and we are striving to be saved, we are striving to enter the kingdom of heaven in the age to come, what is it that we plan to do there? The kingdom of heaven is described in the Holy Scriptures, especially in the book of Revelation, as unceasing worship of God, unceasing song, unceasing hymnody offered before the throne of God, in communion with the angels, the saints, the martyrs, all the company of heaven. And this image that the book of Revelation gives to us is what the church dimly, imperfectly, replicates here on earth. So our churches, our church buildings, the temples, they resemble what the kingdom of heaven is depicted like in heaven. We have the throne of God. We have the saints and apostles around that throne, surrounding him. And we come before that throne to offer our worship and to unite our worship to the worship of heaven. And that's another important point, that the worship that we offer in the church on earth is already united, is already one with the worship of the kingdom of heaven. And this is especially evident in the divine liturgy itself, the celebration of the Holy Eucharist. In the Eucharist, in the anaphora, we sing the thrice holy hymn, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord of Sabaoth, heaven and earth are full of thy glory." And the priest introduces that hymn by saying, that by thanking God for accepting our liturgy, even though there stand by him thousands of archangels, the hosts of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim borne aloft, soaring on their pinions, singing the triumphant hymn, shouting, proclaiming, and saying, and then we all join in, "Holy, holy, holy." We join in with the thrice holy hymn of the angelic hosts. But immediately following that hymn in the liturgy, when the priest continues with his part of the anaphora, he says, With these blessed powers, that's the angels, with these blessed powers, O Master, who lovest mankind, we also cry aloud to thee and say, Holy art thou, and all holy, thou and thine only begotten Son, and thine all holy Spirit. So we intentionally unite our worship to that of the angels. And we could go a step further, really an infinite step further, and say that we unite our worship to that of Christ himself. And for this theme of the Lord worshiping and offering prayer and offering intercession before the throne of his Father on our behalf, that's a theme that's most especially found in the scriptures in the Epistle to the Hebrews. So the epistle in the Epistle to the Hebrews, the apostle talks about Christ as the high priest who has made an offering not of lambs or other animals, but he has made the offering of himself on the cross. And that then, after his resurrection, he ascends into heaven, the Feast of the Ascension, 40 days after Pascha. He ascends to heaven with his flesh, with his human flesh, so that he there in heaven, in the presence of God his Father, makes the priestly offering of that flesh and blood which was shed on the cross. And so that offering that he makes in heaven is precisely the same offering. It is the identical offering that we make in Christ, through Christ, on earth when we celebrate the Divine Liturgy. So, and then what we offer to God is offered back to us. So we offer to God the work of our own hands, bread and wine, which are not simply elements of creation. We don't offer wheat and grapes. We offer bread and wine. That is to say, we take things which God made and then we do something to them. We craft them into something else. That we craft them into something that is made by human beings. We offer this bread and wine, but the Lord takes this offering and transforms it into the offering of his body and blood. And that is offered to his Father in union with the offering that the Lord perpetually makes in heaven, as described in the Epistle to the Hebrews. And then we are given that offering back. The Lord gives it back to us. He offers it to us. So everything that we offer to God is something which he then offers back to us. And this is a very important principle of liturgy, of worship in the church. It is first and foremost, it is fundamentally an offering that we make to God. Okay? It's not primarily something that we do for other people that come to church. Priests and deacons, readers, singers, chanters, choir directors, people that make flower arrangements, people that paint icons, whatever kind of role you have in church, and that may not be an active, outward, physical role. It may primarily be an inward, spiritual role. The offering that you make in your heart. Whatever the offering is, though, that you make in church, you're primarily doing it as something given to God. But the mercy of God always transforms our offerings and gives them back to us. The more we take care to offer God our best, the more we take care to offer God what is most precious to us, then the more we will receive in return. So, the book of Revelation gives us this image of the worship of the kingdom of heaven as our human worship being united to that of the angelic hosts. The epistle to the Hebrews gives us this vision of the worship of the kingdom of heaven as the offering of Christ himself to God his Father. And that offering we are also united to, because we in the church are members of Christ's body. And so therefore what the head does, Christ, we participate in that. And that especially happens in the Divine Liturgy. So these two books are very important in the New Testament for our understanding of worship. But I want to briefly finish this section by saying, by emphasizing one point again, which is that participation in the services of the church is not always, and even not primarily, a matter of outward actions. In fact, those who sing, those who serve in the altar, those who offer the liturgy, priests, deacons, readers, choir directors, all of these roles have as primarily their goal to foster the ability for everyone in church to make a spiritual offering, an offering of the attention. You could say an offering of the attention of the nous, that attentive aspect of the soul. We might call it the heart. This attentiveness, which we use our ears for, especially our ears and our eyes, to listen and to look, to hear the hymns and the prayers, to gaze upon the icons and upon the actions of the ministers. This attentiveness is itself the fundamental offering which each Orthodox Christian makes when he comes to church. And this is really an important point, because I think especially in 20th century Christianity, largely in Western churches, we've lost sight of this fact. You'll often hear about sort of people who go to church as a passive audience. They're sung too, but they don't sing. But this is a misunderstanding, because listening, hearing, is actually a greater form of participation in the liturgy than singing. And those who are given the responsibility to sing, or to direct choirs, or to do any of those other outward active roles, they are making a sacrifice, actually, of that kind of inner attentiveness. That attentiveness is something that then gets sacrificed for the sake of others. So when I'm directing the choir, I have 800 things to worry about. But one of those things is that's kind of down on the list is my own inward attentiveness. I have to sacrifice that for the sake of others. So that's a really important point to make about the divine services. But the fact is that those of us who are in seminary and we're preparing for future ministry in the church, your husbands are preparing in a certain way, and you are preparing in another way. But it very often is the case that clergy wives are called upon to take a kind of active role in the worship of the church. If the father of the parish has scheduled vespers, but no one else comes to sing, you're there. So it's good for you to be able to know what to do. And so that's kind of the point of this class. To begin to have a familiarity with this subject, so that if the time comes that you are called upon to make this outward offering, you have a good foundation. And I emphasize that phrase, called upon to make an offering. The church needs people to make certain offerings, and as St. Paul says, the Lord loves a cheerful giver. That's a really important point of life in the church, that when we're asked to make an offering, we respond cheerfully. We respond with love for the church and out of love for Christ. And sometimes, there are many times, really, throughout the year, that you don't feel very cheerful. At least I don't. And those of you who sing in my choir know that all too well. But so that's why we have forgiveness and confession and repentance, and we try again to make our offering one of cheerfulness one of joy. So that's kind of a very quick scriptural, spiritual summary of the importance of the topic, but there is no topic more important, as I say, because this is what we plan to spend all eternity doing. If we ask for salvation, this is what we're asking for. Now, the worship in the kingdom of heaven will be very different. But today we're going to focus on what the worship on earth looks like and how it's developed in the life of the church. And the best way to understand this, first of all, is by understanding the church calendar. What does the church year look like? And the best way to approach that topic is to realize that there are actually two calendars that are constantly at work with each other throughout the year, that kind of interplay with each other and relate to each other. So I'm going to ask you two trick questions to illustrate this point. All right? So the first question is, what date, so month and day, what date does Pascha fall on? There is no answer to this question. The answer is that it falls on the Sunday after the first full moon, after the vernal equinox. And in the Orthodox Church, we have to add that the vernal equinox is according to the Julian calendar, not according to the Gregorian calendar, which is why our Pascha is often out of sync with that of Western churches. So no date for Pascha. Now, here's another question, another trick question. What day of the week does Christmas fall on? So by your silence, I can tell that you've seen through my trick. And you see that there is no answer to that question either. Christmas is always on December 25th, but December 25th is not always on the same day of the week. It changes every year. So while Pascha is always on a Sunday, it's always on the same day of the week. Christmas is always on the same date, but occurs on different days. That, in a nutshell, can be said, something similar can be said of every single feast in the church year. Every date of the calendar year, of which there are 365 of them, or in leap years like this year, 366, every date has its own commemoration, its own either the commemoration of an event of salvation or the commemoration of a saint. And so each of those dates will not fall on the same day of the week every year. But at the same time, there's a whole other layer of commemorations in the church year that is based on the day of Pascha. And the date of Pascha changes every year. So the date of Pascha doesn't just affect itself. It affects every Sunday of the year following that Pascha. And it affects several Sundays prior to that Pascha. In fact, we just had the first one of those Sundays yesterday, the Sunday of the Publican and Pharisee, which is the beginning of the whole lead-up to Pascha. So, if Pascha this year were, say, 2 weeks earlier than it actually is, then our celebration of Publican and Pharisee would have been 2 weeks ago, not yesterday. So, we have these two layers, the fixed date calendar and the movable date. You've probably heard the phrase movable feast. A movable feast is a feast that is based on the date of Pascha. And those movable feasts tend to be fixed to a particular day of the week. So Pascha is always on a Sunday. Ascension is always on a Thursday. Pentecost is always on a Sunday, etc. So we're going to talk in some detail about this thing on the board. I don't know quite what to call it, this sort of liturgical map. But already I think you can begin to see that there are a couple of different layers here. This middle layer is what is based on the date of Pascha. And this bottom layer, and you see these specific dates of the year listed, this bottom layer is what is there for the fixed date feasts. For a shorthand, we could refer to this layer, the Paschal layer, as what's based on the lunar calendar. So the calendar having to do with the moon, because ultimately the date of Pascha is based on when there's a full moon. It's the first full moon after the vernal equinox. But then this date, this calendar, we can refer to as the solar calendar. So it's called the solar calendar because this is the year, and the year is based on the Earth's orbit around the sun. Okay. Any questions so far? Or any comments? Y'all with me?
Why is it on the moon?
Why is it on the moon? Well, that's a good question. Pascha, the date of Pascha relates to the Old Testament Passover. In fact, it's the same word. Pascha means Passover. And the Lord gave instructions to Moses about when to keep the Passover. And the Passover was to be kept on the 14th day of the month of Nisan, which was a Jewish month. But the Jewish months were based strictly on the lunar cycle. In fact, the word month has to do with the word moon. So the Jews' calendar was based on the cycles of the moon. So we see there this connection with of Pascha with everything that preceded it in the Old Testament, with the Exodus from Egypt, of which it is the fulfillment. Other questions? Okay. Well, then I think the next phase for us tonight is we're going to talk about the liturgical books. We're going to name them, describe them, see what they're used for, and then we're going to sort of later on see how they all fit together. Now you have in front of you this other handout called Liturgical Resources, Print and Web. And the way this is organized is by liturgical book. These are different classifications of liturgical texts. And this is the best way to understand how the services work, is to understand what each of these books does and what its role is and when it's used. So this is going to be kind of heavy in vocabulary, and mostly Greek vocabulary. Of course, our liturgical tradition in the Byzantine Rite comes from the Eastern Roman Empire, which was Greek-speaking. So most of our liturgical terms are Greek words. And this can be a little confusing if you're not familiar with these words at first, because a lot of them can all begin to sound the same. But the more you use these words, the more familiar they get, and you begin to remember what they mean. And some of the words are kind of obvious what their root word is. And the first book that we're going to look at here is the Horologion. We have that written up here. Horologion. And the root word for Horologion is the same word as hour. So we could call the Horologion the Book of Hours. The Horologion is basically the book that contains the texts of the services that don't change. So the psalms and prayers and other verses and hymns that are the same almost every day of the year, regardless of what feast you're commemorating, regardless of what fast you might happen to be in. The Horologion gives you you might call it the skeleton or the framework on which the variable hymns are placed and situated. The reason it's called the Book of Hours is because it contains prayers at set hours of the day. So we have midnight office, which is in the middle of the night, obviously. Matins, which is a service at dawn. First hour, third hour, sixth hour, ninth hour. And these services are short services, and they refer to the Roman clock, in which first hour is roughly 7 a.m. in our reckoning of time. Third hour is 9 a.m., sixth hour is noon, ninth hour is 3 p.m. The Horologion gives you the service of Vespers, which is sunset service. And it finally wraps up with the service of Compline, which is the service before going to sleep. So the Horologion has the hours. The companion to the Horologion is the Hieratikon. And that's, I think on this list, that might not be the very next thing. No, the Hieratikon is, I put it towards the end, number six, where it says liturgicon or hieratikon. Those words are interchangeable. And then I also give the Russian, the Slavonic words, služebnik. The hieratikon, the root word there is the Greek word for priest. The Greek word for priest is ierevs. So hieratikon, meaning the same root word as for sacred. So the hieratikon is the book that the priest and deacon use when they serve. But the reason that I've grouped it here together with Horologion is because both of these books contain the texts that are not changing, that remain the same throughout the year. I put them in the same color, brown. And you see that this box, this block representing the Hieratikon and the Horologion together, it just goes throughout the entire year. It's used every day of the year. I'm going to hold up a couple examples of a Horologion and a Hieratikon. And you have the bibliographical information for some of these different editions. The Horologion, this is the Jordanville edition, and this is the Antiochian liturgicon. Remember, liturgicon and hieratikon are the same thing, pre-service book. Notice right away that these books give you, they are arranged for use according to who you are, okay? This is primarily for readers and chanters, and this is for clergy. Now there are other editions of these books in English. All these books that I've spread out here are English liturgical books, okay? And there are often several different editions of each type of book, because unfortunately we have multiple jurisdictions and they come up with multiple translations of things. In some cases they have slightly different rubrics based on the practice of each jurisdiction. But it's helpful conceptually to think of them in according to their classification. So there are a couple of other Horologia worth mentioning. This one called the Great Horologion is from the Holy Transfiguration Monastery in Boston, which is according to the Greek practice, Greek tradition. This one is from St. Tikhon's in Pennsylvania. This one is actually out of print, but God willing, there will be a new edition of it one of these years, which I will probably be editing. So we have Jordanville, St. Tikhon's, Transfiguration. They all basically give you the same thing, the reader's part of the services. Horologion, okay? Hieratikon, or liturgicon, the priest's and deacon's book. I already showed you the Antiochian book. This is a very fine book, the Liturgicon, especially for those of you who are in the Antiochian Archdiocese. This is an invaluable resource to use to get to know the services, because it actually includes a lot of the material that a Horologion would contain. So this is kind of Hieratikon plus. You get bonus material with this book. And it's very detailed. It gives very good explanations of how the services go. But this is according to Antiochian practice. For the OCA, which follows Russian practice, the priests and deacons use books primarily from St. Tikhon's Press. And the Hieratikon basically comes in two volumes. This book, which is quite new, a couple years old, which I edited, this has the services of the hours, the office, so Vespers, Matins, the hours, Compline. In other words, all the daily services except Divine Liturgy. And this book, it says Divine Liturgy on it, this contains the text of the three Divine Liturgies. So St. John Chrysostom, which is what we usually use, St. Basil the Great, which is used 10 times a year, and the Presanctified Liturgy, used during Lent. So these two books combined would give you a complete Hieratikon. The Antiochian one has everything. Okay. So these two rows, Horologion, Hieratikon, they're a team. They work together. And together they give you the complete text of the part of the service that does not change every day, okay? The parts of the services that do change according to what you're commemorating, whether it's the Feast of Christmas or Pascha or the third Sunday in Lent or the fourth Tuesday after Pascha, whatever it may be, that's what all the rest of these books are for. So these books, basically from here to here, these are books full of hymnography. So the variable portions of the service, the portions that tell you what feast you're celebrating or what commemoration you're keeping, that part comes to us in the hymns of the service. And we'll talk more about what these hymns are next time. Stichira, Troparia, Kondakia, canons, these types of things. But it's in the hymnography of the church, that the variable hymnography, the parts that change at every service, this is where we have such a unique treasure. And this is why missing services, you really miss out. Because this part stays the same at almost every service. Every Vespers, you're going to hear Psalm 103. Every liturgy, you're going to hear the Great Litany. If you miss it one day, you'll get it the next day. But this stuff, this is what you miss. If you miss a feast day, you know, you're not going to hear those hymns until the following year, for example. And it's in these category of books that contain the hymnography that we really start to see the interplay of the two calendars, the lunar calendar and the solar calendar. And we're going to take a look at the next... Yeah, I regret the order I put these in this handout. We're going to take things a little bit out of order. But we're going to start with number 2, the Octoechos. And it says, also known as Parakritiki. But the Octoechos, you can tell sort of from its roots what it refers to. Octo is 8. Echos is tone. So the Octoechos is the book of the 8 tones. And you can say, well, Father Herman, you told us that this wasn't going to be about chanting. This wasn't going to be a music introduction. But now you're telling us about 8 tones, which are musical terms. Well, this is true. But what we have to understand about the Octoechos is that the tone that something is sung in determines not only what melody you use for it, but it also tells you what the text itself is. Let me explain. The Octoechos is basically an 8-week long cycle. Okay? So we have a yearly cycle, and we have a weekly cycle, and we have a daily cycle. But we also have a cycle that goes through the course of 8 weeks. So what happens is, on Saturday night, every Saturday night and Vespers, we begin a new tone. We call it the tone of the week. So for example, 2 nights ago, on Saturday night at Vespers, we started the week of tone 5. That happens to be where we are right now in the cycle, tone 5. And there were certain hymns that were sung in tone 5 at that service. And there are certain hymns that are sung in tone 5 at every service, at every Vespers and Matins this week. So if you came to church tonight, for example, at Vespers, we started off by singing some hymns in tone 5. And those hymns are a predetermined text. They follow... So, for example, the hymns that are sung on Monday night Vespers, like what we just did earlier tonight, in tone 5, those are different words than what happens next week on Monday night Vespers when we are singing in tone 6. So it's not just that we're singing the same hymn to a different melody. No, we're actually singing a different hymn. And that's why the Octoechos is divided up into 8 tones, and for each of those tones, it gives you a week's worth of hymns. So here is, it says parakletiki, it uses that other word that I mentioned. Parakletiki, weekly offices, it says tone 1. And I open this up, and it begins, it gives me Saturday night Vespers, because that's where each tone begins. And then it gives me Sunday Matins. And then it would give me the hymns for Sunday night Vespers. And then it would give me the hymns for Monday morning Matins, etc. And it goes through the whole week. And when I get all through the week and I get to Saturday morning, and I finish Matins on Saturday morning, I put tone 1 away, done with it, and I have to take out tone 2. I don't have tone 2 with me to demonstrate to you, but I take out the next volume of the Octoechos, I'd open it up, and then begin tone 2 on Saturday night Vespers. And not only is it a different set of tones, a different melody, but it's also a different text. So the Octoechos is kind of the one of the most fundamental strata of our hymnography, of the variable hymns that we use. And each day of the week has a particular theme, or in some cases two themes, which the Octoechos takes us through. So beginning on Saturday night and continuing on Sunday morning Matins, the theme is that of the resurrection, because Sunday, the Lord's Day, is the day of the resurrection. In fact, I think it's important enough to write these out. I should have done this earlier. Space here. So Sunday, resurrection. Monday has two themes. The theme of compunction or repentance. So the hymns for Monday focus on repentance. And the second theme is that of the angels. Monday is the day that we commemorate every week the angels, the bodiless powers of heaven. Tuesday also has two themes. The first theme
is a repeat of Monday, compunction. And some of the hymns are actually the same. Some of the Monday hymns and Tuesday hymns are identical, but not all of them. And the second theme for Tuesday is St. John the Baptist, the Holy Forerunner. Wednesday is the theme of, well, there are, again, two themes. First of all, the cross and the passion of Christ. And secondly, the Mother of God, which I abbreviate with the Greek initials, Mater Theou, Mother of God. Now, you'll notice that Wednesday is a fast day every week. Not this week, but most weeks. Wednesday is a fast day. That's because of this theme of the cross. And Wednesday is chosen mostly because Wednesday was the day that the Lord was betrayed by the false disciple Judas and was sold into the hands of evil men. Thursday also has two themes. They're related themes, though. Firstly, the apostles. And secondly, St. Nicholas of Myra and Lycia, St. Nicholas the Wonder Worker. Thursday, think about the connections of Thursday with the apostles. Thursday is the day of the mystical supper in Holy Week, the day that Christ washed his disciples' feet and gave them the ministry of the Holy Eucharist. Thursday is also the day that the apostles beheld their master ascend into heaven, 40 days after Pascha. So this apostolic theme on Thursday. And St. Nicholas is chosen as well for Thursday because he is the kind of archetypal bishop, hierarch. And the bishops are the successors of the apostles. Friday, just like Wednesday, it has the themes of the cross and of the Mother of God. And Saturday, the last day of the week, has two themes, that of All Saints with particular focus on the martyrs, the saints who died by martyrdom, All Saints and the Departed. So Saturday is a day set aside especially for prayers for the dead, which will become very evident during Lent when we have memorial liturgies every Saturday. But you see that there's kind of a progression. On Friday we have the cross and the passion of Christ. He died on a Friday, obviously. Saturday we commemorate the departed, because Saturday is the day that the Lord himself spent in the tomb, thus fulfilling the Sabbath, the Old Testament Sabbath. He spent the seventh day resting from his labors in the tomb, as we sing on Holy Saturday. And then that leads us back again to Sunday, the day of the resurrection, the fulfillment of the entire week. Not just the first day of the week, but also, as we say, the eighth day of the week, that which fulfills the seventh day. Okay, so this was a bit of an aside, but the point of giving you the themes for each day of the week is that these are the topics that the hymns of the Octoechos sing about. So if we start in tone one on Saturday night, we go through all these themes throughout the week, and then once we get to tone two, the next Saturday night, we start over again, and we cycle through these hymns again. There are different texts, but they have the same themes. And those themes are determined by the day of the week. And so, since the Octoechos is an 8-week long cycle, we could basically think of it as a 56-day cycle. 8 times 7, 56. So the Octoechos contains 56 sets of hymns. 56 days worth of hymns. Make sense?
Maybe I haven't noticed. So in 56 days, the exact same hymns repeat.
Correct.
I mean, okay. And the Menaion, I mean, Polycarp of Smyrna, for example, it stays the same each year. I mean, he's going to have the same tone in a year.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right. Exactly. Yeah. So that's the Octoechos. I brought a couple of different editions. These are older editions. These were made by the nuns in the monastery in France, Bouzy en Haute. Mother Mary was the translator. They're typewritten. These were done in the days before personal computers, mostly in the 70s she did them. She did an immense amount of work. Pretty graphics. There's a newer edition of the Octoechos, which comes from St. John of Kronstadt Press in Tennessee, translated by Isaac Lambertson. And we have two this is set up with two tomes per volume. So in this case, the complete Octoechos is 4 volumes. That gives you all 8 tomes. This is a more complete translation than Mother Mary's. I think both translations have different strengths and weaknesses as translations, but that's always the case with translations. In both cases, the editors and the translator did an immense amount of work. But I think that we still have a ways to go in the realm of Octoechos. We could still come up with, I think, some better additions. God willing, that will happen. And I think I give you, I say in my handout there that the Mother Mary Bouzy en Haute Octoechos is available, at least it was, from Light and Life, and also from Eighth Day Books in Wichita, Kansas. But you don't have to go to Wichita, you can order it. So that's the important thing to understand about the Octoechos, though, is that it's part of the lunar cycle. It's based on the date of Pascha. Okay, the Octoechos begins a certain number of Sundays after Pascha. The fact that we are in tone 5 this week right now is entirely due to whenever the date of Pascha was last spring. If Pascha had been a little later, we would not be in tone 5 right now, we'd be in tone 4 or tone 3 or whatever. Okay? Yes.
Does it always start at tone 1 after the Pentecostarion?
It actually starts in tone 8. Okay. Yeah, that's a little twist for you. The Octoechos begins in tone 8 after the Sunday after Pentecost.
And then my other question is, the Anastasius website, is that his own translations?
Yes. Anastasius.org.uk are the translations of Archimandrite Ephrem Lash. He's done a lot of work, and he has put much of that work available online. So that can be a useful resource. Now, there are two other books that are used in the lunar cycle. Okay? So we're not going to talk about the Menaion right now. We'll get to the Menaion in a minute. But we're going to keep with the lunar cycle, the cycle of hymns and commemorations based on the date of Pascha. And we're going to talk about the Triodion and the Pentecostarion. And you'll notice in my list here, I have these three books grouped together. Octoechos, Triodion, Pentecostarion. Because they work as a team. Okay? Those three sets of books
function according to the date of Pascha, according to the lunar calendar. So the Octoechos, we said, is an 8-week cycle that just repeats itself throughout the year. But at a certain point, right about the beginning of Lent, we'll talk about this in a little more detail in a bit, mm-hmm. at a certain point, the Octoechos, represented by the green, gives way to the Triodion, represented by the purple. I chose purple because we often wear purple during Lent, purple vestments. So the Triodion is the book that contains all of the hymnography for the period of Great Lent and for the pre-Lenten period that we began just yesterday. And it goes all the way through Holy Week. The Triodion ends with Holy Saturday. Holy Saturday is the last day of the Triodion. The Sunday of the Publican and the Pharisee, yesterday, is the first day of the Triodion. And so you'll notice that there are a couple little slivers of purple here, because for the first couple of weeks, the Triodion is only used on Sunday. So we used the Triodion yesterday and Saturday night for the Sunday of Publican and Pharisee. But the next time that we'll use the Triodion won't be till next Sunday, the Sunday of the Prodigal Son. This week, during the week, if you come to Vespers or Matins, you won't hear anything from the Triodion. It's not until the week before Lent, the week of Cheese Fair, that we begin to use the Triodion every day of Lent. Every day of the week. And then, beginning with Lent, the Octoechos drops out completely. And we use the Triodion and the Menaion. I'm getting ahead of myself, though. So let me back up a bit and speak more fundamentally about the Triodion. So we could say that, we said that the Octoechos contains a complete set of hymns for a 56-day cycle that repeats itself throughout the year. The Triodion contains a set of hymns for every day of Lent and every day of Holy Week. And it contains sets of hymns for the 3 Sundays leading up to Lent. I should say the 4 Sundays leading up to Lent. The Sunday of the Publican and Pharisee, the Sunday of the Prodigal Son, the Sunday of Meat Fair, also known as the Sunday of the Last Judgment, and the Sunday of Cheese Fair, also known as Forgiveness Sunday, or the Sunday of the Casting Out of Adam from Paradise, which is the theme of the hymns on that day. Now, our English edition of the Triodion comes in 2 volumes. And this is important to understand. These 2 books together make up a complete English Triodion. They published it this way because they wanted to make, they didn't want this book to be overly big, but they wanted it, if you could only buy one book, this book gives you most of what you need, especially for parish practice. So the first volume, the primary volume of the Triodion, it contains all the Sundays of Lent and of pre-Lent. It contains every day of the first week of Lent. And the first week of Lent is often celebrated more rigorously, more fully than the subsequent weeks of Lent. And this book contains every day of Holy Week, leading up to Pascha. So the second volume, which is called the Lenten Triodion Supplement, the second volume contains all the days that are missing from the first volume. So this contains the weekdays of the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th weeks of Lent. Now, both books together, I want to emphasize here, the Triodion is of immense, immense importance for all Orthodox Christians to know, to have, to be familiar with.
Even if you're not doing services every day during Lent, you should still have both volumes, because this is a treasure house. The theology, the hymns, the themes that are sung about in this book are so beautiful, so overwhelmingly inspiring, that it's really one book. The Triodion should be right next to our Bibles, really, in terms of the importance in our spiritual lives. We can't be too familiar with these books. By the way, before they came out with this hardbound copy of the supplement, there was a softbound. This is an older edition. It's the same text. It's precisely the same translation. It's a translation by Mother Mary, the same nun from France that we talked about with the Octoechos. Mother Mary, but her work in the case of the Triodion was edited and revised by Metropolitan Callistos, the English bishop. So that's why it says the authors or the translators, Mother Mary and Bishop Callistos. It's a fine, fine translation. The style, the English style, is, I think, one of the best in terms of liturgical English that we have. And it's I often wish and regret that Bishop Callistos didn't do more work in this area, and I'm not sure that he's planning to at this point. So if you have either this or this, plus the blue volume, then you have a complete Triodion. The reason it's called the Triodion, it's kind of obscure. Octoechos, Horologion, these are all very obvious names. Triodion means three odes, the book of the three odes. And it has to do with the structure of the canon at Matins during Lent. I'm not going to go into much detail about this right now. But normally, a canon at Matins has eight odes. Odes 1 through 9, skipping over ode 2. But during Lent, the canon at Matins has three odes. And so that characteristic of the Lenten order of service gave its name to the book itself, the Triodion. That's just a little fact for you, fun fact, okay? So, continuing on with the lunar cycle, we've had the Octoechos, the Triodion for Lent. When we hit Pascha, so we said the last days of the Triodion are Holy Week. The last day of the Triodion is Holy Saturday. Pascha starts, and we switch to the Pentecostarion. And there's even a note in the Triodion. It says, and so the period of the Lenten Triodion has come to a close, and we put it aside, and we take out the Pentecostarion. And we begin the bright and joyful celebration of Christ's resurrection. So there's this idea that, you know, you're standing at the chanter stand and you put one book away and you take out another book. And this changing of the books symbolizes this great moment in the church year where we transition from Holy Week into Pascha, this great joyful moment. But the Pentecostarion is rather like the Triodion because it contains a set of hymns for every day of this entire period. So it's not like the Octoechos, it's not a repeating cycle. It is actually pretty much one 8-week cycle. Because it takes you from Pascha to the Feast of Pentecost, which I need to label here. This is Pentecost right here. And the word Pentecost means 50, or 50th. Pentecost is 50 days after Pascha. Oh, heavens, and I completely forgot to include the Feast of the Ascension, which is a great, great error on my part, because Ascension is a very important feast, and it is under-recognized how important it is. So, the word Pentecostarion comes from the title of the Feast of Pentecost, the 50th day of Pascha. So it's the book that covers this period of 50 days from Pascha to Pentecost, the descent of the Holy Spirit. But actually it gives us one more week after Pentecost, because it takes us through the period of the after-feast of Pentecost. We'll talk about an after-feast in a minute. Up to the Sunday of All Saints. And then, following that, we resume the use of the Octoechos, indicated with the green here. And the Octoechos then starts here on the Monday after All Saints, and then it continues, it just continues to the beginning of the next year until we finally hit the Triodion once again. So, Octoechos, Triodion, Pentecostarion, they all work as a team. They are what gives us the complete set of hymns for the lunar cycle, the cycle of commemorations based on the date of Pascha. And there are a couple of editions of the Pentecostarion in English. There are three of them that I know of, three complete or nearly complete Pentecostaria. One is this one from St. John of Kronstadt Press, translated by Isaac Lambertson, just like the Octoechos here, same translator. This is a complete complete Pentecostarion. It gives you the Russian, the Slavic practice and directions. That's in English. Another example of Mother Mary's work from France, Boussy-en-Volt. She did a Pentecostarion. Again, it's one of these typewritten manuscripts, although it's actually very neat. I like reading out of it. This book is not a complete Pentecostarion. This gives you Sundays and feast days. So it gives you every Sunday during Paschaltide. It gives you Ascension, Mid-Pentecost, Pentecost, All Saints. So Sundays and feasts, which is what most parishes would find necessary to have. There's a third edition of the Pentecostarion, which wasn't able to bring tonight. That's from Holy Transfiguration Monastery in Boston, the same folks that did the Horologion. And that's a complete Pentecostarion that follows the Greek practice. Okay, you with me so far? Okay? You're not hopelessly confused yet? All right. So that basically concludes this stratum of the service books, the lunar cycle. So we've talked about how the Horologion and the Hieratikon, how they give us the non-variable texts, the parts of the service that stay the same each day of the year. We've talked about the lunar cycle, Octoechos, Triodion, Pentecostarion, those three sets of books that whose hymns, whose commemorations are based on the date of Pascha. And now we're going to talk about the third line here in the blue, the Menaion. The Menaion comes from the Greek word for month. And this is these give us the services for the commemorations that have fixed dates, so that stay the same every year. So like Christmas, all the great the great feasts like Theophany, Annunciation, these are all in the Menaion. The reason that it's called the Menaion is because a complete Menaion is arranged by month. So you'd have 12 volumes. I have two of them here to illustrate. January, February. We have all 12 volumes, but I didn't think it was necessary to show them all to you. You get the idea. This is the edition that I'm holding up for you right now is from Holy Transfiguration Monastery in Boston, which I've mentioned before with regard to the Pentecostarion and the Horologion. And like their other service books, these editions from Boston are particularly useful if you are singing in Byzantine chant and you are singing the correct prosomian melodies, the appointed proper melodies for the hymns, because the Byzantine melodies are based on meter, the number of syllables that you have in each line of poetry in the hymns. And they were able to translate the hymns into English in such a way to retain that meter, to preserve the number of syllables, accented and unaccented syllables, so that you can sing them to the same melodies. Now that perforce means that this is more of in some cases, more of a paraphrase than a translation. Because you can't do a very literal translation and preserve the meter. You can kind of do one or the other. So be aware of that. But it's very useful if you are singing Byzantine chant. Not as useful if you're singing Russian chant, because Russian chant doesn't depend on meter the way Byzantine chant does. And there are other translations of the Menaion based on Slavic practice. The main one is that of, again, Isaac Lambertson, who we mentioned with the Octoechos and the Pentecostarion. Isaac Lambertson has done an immense amount of work in translation. And he did a complete Menaion, which you can get, again, from St. John of Kronstadt Press in Tennessee. So a Menaion will have 365 services in it, one for each day of the calendar year. It actually has 366 days, because it has a service for February 29th, which we get to use this year, the feast of St. John Cassian. St. John Cassian, his feast day is on February 29th. That doesn't mean that he only gets a feast every 4 years, because in other years, his feast gets moved to the day before, to the 28th. St. John Cassian is a very important saint. We don't want to omit him. But there is another volume that in the Menaion row here, and that is this book called the Festal Menaion. And I really want to draw your attention to this book. This book is really important to have on your shelves, along with your Bible and your Triodion, your Lenten Triodion. In fact, these two books, the Lenten Triodion, the Festal Menaion, were done by the same translators, Mother Mary from France, and her work edited by Bishop Callistos from England. And again, I highly value his work as a translator of English. He really has a beautiful, poetic, dignified approach to English that very few other Orthodox translators have been able to approach. He has a certain upbringing in England that lent itself to this. And if you heard him speak, you know that how good he is with words. The reason that I highly value these two books is not only because of their content, the hymns that they contain. This gives you the hymns for the... Let me back up for a second. What is a Festal Menaion? It contains 9 dates out of the year. So it is a... It contains a few services of what is in a complete Menaion. But they are 9 of the most important dates out of the year. That is to say, they are the 9 great feasts of the church year that have fixed dates. And those 9 feasts are September 8th, the Nativity of the Mother of God. September 14th, the Exaltation of the Cross. November 21st, the Entrance of the Mother of God into the Temple. December 25th, the Nativity of Christ, Christmas. January 6th, the Feast of Theophany. February 2nd, the Meeting of Christ in the Temple that we just celebrated a couple weeks ago. March 25th, Annunciation. August 6th, the Transfiguration of Christ. And August 15th, the Dormition of the Mother of God. These are the 9 great feasts contained in this book. Now, you might be thinking, well, Father Herman, aren't there 12 great feasts? What about the other 3? Yes, there are 12 great feasts, in a manner of speaking. But the other 3 are Palm Sunday, Ascension, and Pentecost. And these 3 great feasts are not in the Menaion because they are part of the lunar cycle, not the solar cycle. So they are based on the date of Pascha. So Palm Sunday is always a week before Pascha, and therefore Palm Sunday is the only great feast that is contained in the Triodion. And Ascension and Pentecost are 40 days and 50 days after Pascha, respectively, Thursday and a Sunday. And so these are the 2 great feasts that are contained in the Pentecostarion. So that's why the book called the Festal Menaion contains only those nine great feasts on the fixed date calendar. A complete Menaion, 12 volumes, will contain these 9. So it's not as if these 9 aren't contained in a complete Menaion. They are. But this is a very convenient book to have because it's smaller, and these particular feasts are so very important for the church. And as I was about to say a moment ago, the other reason that I really recommend becoming very familiar with this set of books, the Festal Menaion and the Lenten Triodion in these editions, is because they contain a great wealth of information about our services. They have appendices, introductions, glossaries. They have very detailed rubrics. And so as a way of kind of entering into this subject, you can't really do better than just sitting down with these books every night for, you know, a couple months, and just leafing through and reading some of that introductory material, looking at the services. They're really valuable as a way to begin to educate yourself about the services, in a way that some of these other books may not be as valuable. They really went out of their way, Bishop Calistos and Mother Mary, to kind of present these books, in a sense, to a Western audience. You know, these books were not originally published by a church press. They are now kept in print by Typikons, but they were originally published by Faber and Faber, you know, just a secular English press, producer of very fine books. But so they had in mind that these books would be read by people that are not Orthodox, that are not familiar with the services. But that can be very useful for us, too. That can be very educational. So I give you a big plug for these. They're available right across the hall there every day. Of course, I hope and presume that your husbands already own copies of these books. But I am somewhat dismayed at times by the number of occasions that I tell my students here to refer to the Festal Menaion, and they look at me like they don't know what I'm talking about. But now you know what I'm talking about, and you can instruct them. So, Octoechos has a 56-day cycle. Triodion, roughly 7 weeks plus a couple Sundays at the front. Pentecostarion, roughly 8 weeks. The Menaion takes you through the entire year. It takes you through the whole year, 365 days. Now, some Menaions will actually have more than one service on certain days, so that you might have a choice of which saint you're going to commemorate on a particular day. So, for example, some Menaeans will have on March 17th. The primary commemoration for March 17th is St. Alexis, the man of God. But especially in English-speaking countries, a lot of Menaea will also include on March 17th a service to St. Patrick of Ireland, because he's very widely venerated in the West. So then it would be up to the priest to decide, well, we're going to do this saint or that saint. So that basically concludes the section of books that give us our variable hymnography. We have the Octoechos, Triodion, Pentecostarion for the lunar cycle, and the Menaion for the fixed date, the solar cycle. Any questions or comments thus far? Yes?
Was Isaac Lambertson translating from Russian or Greek?
He was translating from Slavonic. Most in the Russian church, liturgical texts are not in Russian, they're in Slavonic, which is an older form of that of the Slavic language.
Mother Mary?
Mother Mary translated from Greek with an eye to Slavonic. I think she checked Slavonic as well. And Bishop Callistos also checked both Slavonic and Greek. So very often in these two volumes, they will tell you if there's a difference between what the Slavonic says than what the Greek says, they will give both, and they notate both. Okay?
I had another question.
Yes?
How old are the hymns and the books? I think that somebody said the Triodion was one of the older ones.
The Triodion has elements that go back to probably the 5th century, 5th or 6th century. The oldest hymns of the Triodion are found, actually, you find this interesting, in a Georgian collection called the Yadgari. The Yadgari contains the idiomela for each day of the Triodion, at Matins and Vespers, and I think it might also contain the Troparion of the prophecy at sixth hour for each day. The Octoechos, in some of the oldest parts of the Octoechos date to St. John Damascene in the 7th century. The Menaion has some hymns by St. John Damascene and St. Cosmas, his adoptive brother. St. John Damascene and St. Cosmas, as I say, they were St. Cosmas was adopted by St. John's father, so they grew up together, and they engaged in the pious practice of canon writing competitions. So you will see, if you look in the Festal Menaion, and you look in Matins for each of the nine great feasts, for most of them, Christmas, Theophany, I think maybe Dormition, there are two canons, one by St. John of Damascus, one by St. Cosmas, the hymnographer. And so they both wrote canons, and they tried to sort of see which one would be better. But the church accepted both of them. But there was one canon, one feast, where St. John clearly won, and that was Pascha. The canon that we sing on Pascha. This is the day of resurrection. Let us be illumined, O people, Pascha, the Pascha of the Lord. For from death to life and from earth to heaven, as Christ our God led us, as we sing the song of victory, Christ is risen from the dead, etc. That canon is by St. John of Damascus. But we know from St. Nicodemus of the Holy Mountain, who has a commentary on the canons, on the Great Feast canons in Greek, portions of which were translated by Andrew Louth in a book about St. John. St. Nicodemus tells us a story that has been passed down through many generations on the Holy Mountain. Of course, St. Nicodemus is an 18th century Greek saint. He tells us that St. Cosmas, St. John's brother, also wrote a canon for Pascha, but that St. Cosmas, when they wrote their canons for Pascha, they exchanged them to read each other's work, and St. Cosmas got to a particular troparion in the third ode of the canon, so quite towards the beginning of St. John's canon, and he said, "You win, I give up." He withdrew his canon from the running, as it were. And that troparion that St. Cosmas was so taken with was in the third ode, "Now all is filled with light, heaven and earth and the lower regions. Let all creation celebrate the rising of Christ, in whom we are established. Christ is risen from the dead." And then the one right after it in the same ode. "Yesterday I was crucified with thee, today I arise with thee in thy resurrection. Yesterday I was buried with thee, glorify me with thee, O Savior, in thy kingdom." When St. Cosmas saw those two troparia in the canon of Pascha, he said to his brother, "You win." And so on Pascha we only have one canon by St. John. So those are examples of hymns that date from the 7th century. Most of the Menaion, the canons, the Stichira, are from the 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th centuries. It wasn't really until things really got going that hymnographers started producing hymns for every single saint of the year. And most of those hymns were by St. Joseph, the hymnographer, and also St. Theophanes, the hymnographer. The Triodion, a lot of the hymns are by Saint Theodore the Studite and Saint Joseph of Myuma, who are, I think I would say 7th century saints, but I could be mistaken. So basically, second half of the first millennium is when most of our hymns come from, over that 500 year period. St. Andrew of Crete, who of course wrote the great canon that we sing the first week of Lent at Compline, he was early 7th century. Yes?
I have a small question about the Horologion. Yes. I understand that it's the immovable parts of the services from the Book of Hours.
Right.
But when you mentioned the services of the time of the day, mm-hmm. midnight office and so on.
Yes.
I don't think you mentioned liturgy. And
I did
yet
not.
The immovable parts of the liturgy is in the Horologion too? Or in the
parts of it are, yes. The Horologion will contain the parts of liturgy that the chanters need to have. So it contains the litanies and the responses.
Okay.
And the antiphons of
okay.
liturgy.
Okay.
But it won't contain all of the priest's prayers.
So the priest prayers are in the liturgical.
Correct. The
okay.
liturgicon, aka Hieratikon.
Okay.
Good question.
No.
The other point about the Horologion regarding the times of day is that, in fact, in actual practice, we don't celebrate these services at those set times. So, for example, 6th hour, I told you, was noon, 9th hour was 3 o'clock p.m.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We kind of smush them all together at sets throughout the day. So typically if you go to a monastery where you have all the services done every day, you have matins, first, third, sixth hour, and divine liturgy all in one, it's called an aggregate. So these services are aggregated together. So you have several hours of church in the morning, and then you have the day, most of the day free for your work, uninterrupted, and then in the evening you have another aggregate, 9th hour, vespers, and compline, all stuck together. And different monasteries have different ways of aggregating the services. That's a bit of an aside. We'll talk a bit more about the daily cycle when we meet next time. Now I just want to finish up a couple of other categories of books. On your handout, number 6, on the second page there, it says Euchologion, or Euchologion in Greek, Skrebnik in Slavonic, or in English, Book of Needs. The Book of Needs, the Skrebnik, contains services that do not follow the church calendar. These are services that a priest may have to perform at any point of the year. Things like weddings, baptisms, funerals, holy unction for the bishop, the ordination of priests and deacons and bishops, consecration of churches, molyadens, like services of thanks, of thanksgiving or supplication, paraklesis, blessings of various items, blessing of water, these types of things. So it's called the Book of Needs because it's when you need something, you use it. The Book of Needs, the complete Book of Needs, is available in English from Typikon's press. It's 4 volumes. This is one of the 4 volumes. So it contains a lot of material, a lot of really obscure services. Things like blessing of wells and beehives and the service for the building of a new home. Malevin of supplication in time of war, in time of earthquake. Most anything you can think of, it's in there. Although it might be the case that some new services should be written for more modern day concerns. There is also from St. Tikhon's Press a book called The Small Book of Needs. And I'm the editor, I'm one of the editors of this book, along with Vitaly Permiakov, who teaches at Holy Trinity Jordanville and an alumnus of St. Vladimir's. He also is my co-editor with the Hieratikon. The Small Book of Needs contains a certain selection of services out of the Great Book of Needs. So it's a compendium, an anthology, if you will, which can be handy for a priest to have with him when he's on the go. So the Book of Needs, the Trebnik, the Euchologion, it doesn't figure into this chart because this chart is showing you basically the church year, the daily appointed services that would be used throughout the year. I'm not figuring into this, you know, the fact that you might have a wedding on the 4th Sunday after Pentecost. You know, I didn't show that. So, to recap so far, we have Horologion and Hieratikon or Liturgicon giving you the ordinary, non-changing parts of the services for readers and chanters and for clergy. We have for the lunar cycle, the Octoechos, the Triodion, the Pentecostarion. For most of the year, for Lent, and for Paschaltide. And we have the Menaion for the yearly cycle according to the fixed date, the solar calendar. And we have the Book of Needs for those services that come up at any time of the year based on need. There is also a category that you might call, what I call here in the sheet, category 7, compendia. A compendium, books that contain a little from all of the above. And one of the oldest examples of such books is probably it's one of the oldest books of Orthodox services in English, and that's the famous service book by Isabel Hapgood. And Isabel Hapgood was actually not Orthodox. She was an Anglican, but she knew Slavonic. She knew Russian and Slavonic. She actually translated some Russian novels as well in the late 19th century. And St. Tikhon of Moscow, when he was the Archbishop of North America, he met her, he knew her. St. Tikhon had a lot of connections in the Episcopal Church at the time. And he commissioned her to do this book. And as I say, it's a compendium. It has a little bit of everything. So it has the ordinary services like that you'd find in a Horologion, Vespers, Matins, Liturgy. It has a smattering of stuff from the Octoechos, especially kind of the minimal that you would need for a Sunday service. It doesn't really have much for weekday Octoechos material. It has a smattering of stuff from the great feasts from the Menaion. It has a smattering of stuff that you would need for Lent and Holy Week and Pascha. And it has some of the main services from the Book of Needs, like weddings and funerals and baptisms and such. So under one cover, you know, if you wanted to become familiar with the services and kind of get a general overview, this is a nice book to have. The translation can be kind of rocky at times, as things sometimes English style in the late 19th century could be a bit florid, overly so. But it's very useful. You know, when I was first thinking about becoming Orthodox, when I was a sophomore in college, I read Colossus Ware like most people do, but I read this book too. I honestly read straight through probably about 2/3 of this book, reading all the prayers, the rubrics, just to get a sense of what Orthodox services are like. And that's really, that's an immensely valuable introduction to the life of the church, right there. But not something that many people think of doing. Right, so finally, I'll just read from the handout here at the bottom of page 2. It says, in addition to all the above, all these books, some jurisdictions publish material on their websites for upcoming weekends. This material may be useful in a pinch, but over the long term will make it more difficult to learn the services. So the OCA website, for example, I believe the Antiochian website, the GOA website, maybe not their website, but they have other publications and venues. These jurisdictions offer kind of ready-made packets for you. You download, you print them off, and there you go. You have the whole service ready, and you just sort of sing what it says. But the problem with this is that you don't learn what's going on in the services. And that really is a bigger problem than people might think. Because it leaves you helpless if you don't have access to this kind of material. And it also means that you just don't have a sense of the mind of the church, how the church is combining these different strata. So let me give an example. Someone mentioned a few minutes ago St. Polycarp, who is the saint of the day tomorrow. We began singing his hymns tonight. St. Polycarp comes around February 23rd. That's tomorrow, right? 23rd. Mm-hmm. He is every year February 23rd, regardless of the day of the week. But at the same time, we combine with the Menaion for February 23rd, right around here, we combine the Octoechos, as I said, of tone 5 for Monday evening in tone 5, and tomorrow for Tuesday morning in tone 5. And that particular combination of February 23rd and Tuesday tone 5, that's not going to be the same every year, because the date of Pascha will shift around. And Polycarp won't be on a Tuesday next year. He'll actually be on a Thursday next year because of the leap year. He'll be 2 days later. So the way that these things combine is different every year. And that's one of the great beauties of the church services, because you find then that there are different reflections and resonances between the two cycles that are not the same every year. For example, one of the greatest examples of this that I can think of is about 4 or 5 years ago, the Feast of the 40 Martyrs of Sebaste, which is March 9th. The hymns for that feast recount the conversation that they had with each other, encouraging each other to martyrdom. Brothers, let us strip ourselves naked, because we were stripped naked in paradise as a result of the fall. But we will be clothed with a garment of light if we endure to the end. And we will be glorified, and we will enter paradise. Well, that feast of March 9th fell on the Sunday of Cheese Fair, which, as I mentioned, is the Sunday of the casting out of Adam and Eve from paradise. And so the hymns for that feast, for that commemoration, not a feast, for that sorrowful commemoration, talked about Adam and Eve leaving paradise, being stripped of the garment of glory, and being clothed on with the garment of corruption, the garments of skin, and leaving paradise and petitioning the Lord so that they might enter into paradise again, weeping for their sins. So in the combination of hymns that we had at Vespers, we had first these stikira about Adam and Eve being cast out of paradise and all this themes of stripping and being clothed. And then we had these hymns for the 40 martyrs of Sebaste, which were not written at all to correspond to these other hymns, but that were an amazing connection, because they were saying, let us strip ourselves and suffer this martyrdom that we may regain paradise, and that we may be clothed with glory, and that we may be warm once again in the light of God. Absolutely amazing connection. That would happen, you know, every 10 years or something. It's a very, very rare occurrence. So the interaction of these types, of these two cycles, the lunar and the solar, is really one of the most beautiful elements of the service. And it's important for us to keep in mind that these things happen by God, according to God's providence. We don't plan these things. We have the two cycles, and they interact the way they interact. We don't plan out these things. When you have service texts that just kind of give you the whole thing all stuck together, well, then you lose sight of this. You lose sight of how of the interaction of these two cycles. And I think even worse, you have a packet of papers that you really can't use next year. Because the way that it combines the hymns, I'm talking about these things easily available from websites, the way that it combines the hymns means that it's not going to be of use to you next year because the combination will be different. So these things can be handy, but in the long term, I don't think they're ideal at all. And parishes should build up real liturgical libraries. And not that that's necessarily an easy thing to do, but we need to be going in that direction. And as more becomes available in better editions, that will become more feasible. Finally, the last column here on our table of books is number 8, material from the Typikon. You'll notice that on our big chart on the board, all of these books are bracketed together under this word Typikon. The Typikon is a book, and it's the only liturgical book that is not actually read from in services. So this book does not, this is a Typikon, a very ponderous tome. This is a Typikon in Slavonic. The Typikon does not contain liturgical texts. It doesn't contain prayers or psalms or hymns that we would actually sing in church. This is the book that tells you what to do and how to do it. And specifically, what it tells you is how this cycle interacts with this cycle. It's the book that tells you how to combine these two cycles together on any particular occasion. And as an example, and we're going to take some specific examples next time, but the Feast of the Annunciation on Mark 25th, that falls usually during Lent. But because the date of Pascha can change, imagine if Pascha, instead of being here, were here. Well, that could mean that Annunciation might be on, I don't know, Lazarus Saturday or Palm Sunday. Or if Pascha was a little later, Annunciation might be during the first week of Lent, which is a combination that can only happen on the new calendar. But so Annunciation there are lots of different combinations possible with this great feast. It can fall during Holy Week. It can fall on Holy Friday. Matushka Thekla and I were in our second, my second year in Kodiak, Matushka's fifth year. We had Annunciation on Holy Saturday. Kodiak in Alaska is on the old calendar. So we had this combination of the Feast of Annunciation on Holy Saturday, which was an immensely beautiful experience and rather complicated to put together. But the part of this book, of the Typikon, that deals just with Annunciation is roughly this much. Because it has so many possible variations, depending on what part of Lent, what day of Lent, or even in Bright Week, Annunciation falls on. So that gives you an example of the kind of material that's in the Typikon. The Typikon is not available in English yet, although there are rumors that someone is preparing a translation of the Slavonic Typikon. And I've seen actually parts of it in draft form. It looks quite promising. But even if it were translated, it's actually not a very user-friendly book. You kind of have to know a lot of background information to be able to interpret it correctly. And so as a result, there are other books that have been prepared by people that have expertise in the Typikon that kind of give you this information in a much more usable format. St. Vladimir's Press, a couple years ago, published this book, The Typikon Decoded, by Archbishop Job of Western Europe, in the Ecumenical Patriarchate. And it's basically his textbook, his lecture notes from teaching liturgics in seminary for many years. It's a very nice book. It gives you a brief summary of the history of each service, and then it tells you the order of service and how the hymns are used in each service. Another book that gives you a kind of that gives you a presentation of information from the Typikon is this book, The Order of Divine Services. This is from St. John of Kronstadt Press. We've mentioned them before with regard to the Octoechos, the Pentecostarion. This book is really, really, really valuable. It takes a little bit of getting used to as to how it's laid out. But once you're used to it, most questions that you could ever possibly have about how to combine the different commemorations and what stikira to sing when and how to read canons and all this type of stuff are in this book, answered in this book. So it's a very valuable book. Also, many jurisdictions, such as the OCA, Antiochians, publish an annual liturgical guide. This is 2015, here's 2016. They made the cover red. And this basically lays it out for you. You know, you look up, here's Sunday, May 8th. Second Sunday of Pascha, Tone 1, St. Thomas Sunday, Holy Apostle and Evangelist John the Theologian. So it looks like this year, this coming year, Thomas Sunday, is going to fall on May 8th, which is the Feast of St. John the Theologian, one of the four evangelists. And so normally, we would not use the Menaion, the fixed dates cycle, on Thomas Sunday. But this coming year, because it's such an important commemoration in the Menaion, the evangelist, John the Theologian, it's going to be combined with the commemoration for Thomas Sunday. And that means that you have a book like this that tells you how to make that combination work.
Who is the audience?
The audience of this? Basically, choir directors and priests, and readers and deacons. Right. So, we've got through all the books. We don't have much time left, about 10 more minutes. I do want to just briefly touch on a couple of other details about this this chart that I've been referring to throughout the lecture. I want to talk about great feasts. the first one that we have, well, first of all, let's start with why September? Why is this, why are we starting in September, not January? The answer is that this is the beginning of the church year, starts on September 1st. And that has to do with when the Roman calendar began its year, which was in the fall, not in the middle of the winter. So September 1st, the Menaion has a service for the beginning of the church year. It's a very beautiful service. But it's also interesting to note that the cycle of feasts of the Mother of God corresponds to the church year. So the first feast, the first great feast of the church year is the Nativity of the Mother of God on September 8th. And the last great feast of the church year is the Dormition of the Mother of God on August 15th. So the life of the Mother of God is seen throughout the church year. When we have a great feast, there's usually one day prior to the feast called the Four Feast. And that's why I have these dates up here. It says 7th through 12th. Those refer to the dates in September. The feast itself is on September 8th. But on the 7th, we have a four feast. And then following the feast for about 5 days, we have an after feast that takes us up to the 12th. And on the 12th, we have what's called the leave taking. So most great feasts have four feasts. The feast itself, the feast day, the after feast, and the final day of the after feast is the leave taking. Which sometimes you'll see in the Greek word for that, apodosis, apodosis, leave taking. So for the Feast of the Nativity of the Mother of God, the Four Feast is one day long, September 7th. The Feast is September 8th. After Feast goes up through the 12th, and the 12th is the leave-taking. And then we have back-to-back great feasts, because on September 14th we have the Exaltation of the Cross. And that has one day of Four Feasts, so the 13th. So the day after the leave-taking of the Nativity of the Mother of God is already the Four Feast of the Cross. And we have the leave-taking of the Exaltation of the Cross on the 21st of September. And in this chart, you see that the blue kind of goes up to the other layer and cancels out the green, the Octoechos. And the reason I depict it that way is because when we have great feasts and their period of after feast, then for the most part, all of the hymns come from the Menaion. They are taken for the feast itself, instead of from the Octoechos. So the hymns that would normally, the slots in the service where we would normally sing hymns from the Octoechos, well, instead of that, we have hymns from the Menaion for the feast, the particular feast that we're commemorating. There are many days throughout the year where the Menaion will take over completely and, as I like to say, bump out the Octoechos, where the Octoechos won't get used. I gave a few examples of such. October 1st, the Feast of the Protection of the Mother of God, or the Protecting Veil, often called Pokrov, to use its Russian word. November 8th, the Synaxis of the Holy Archangels. Menaion takes over, Octoechos not used. But then the next great feast is November 21st. And there we, again, have a four feast the day before, the 20th, and we have the leave-taking on the 25th. The entrance of the Mother of God into the temple as a three-year-old girl. We see that the Nativity fast begins on November 15th. That's 40 days before Christmas. But there aren't really that many, especially in the early part of the fast, there's not very much that pertains specifically to the fast in the services. It's very different from Lent. When we get to the Great Fast, it has its own book. It has its own set of hymns. The Nativity Fast, not so much. When we get to the Sundays before, the two Sundays prior to Christmas, then there are special hymns. But for the most part, the hymns are just kind of business as usual during the Nativity Fast. Until we get to December 20th. And December 20th is the beginning of the Christmas Forefeast. The Christmas Forefeast is 5 days long. So it's much more extensive than these other ones that we saw, which are just 1 day long. We have 5 preparatory days leading up to Christmas. And the services for the Christmas Forefeast are exceedingly beautiful. Especially the compline services with the canon. They are an imitation of Holy Week in many ways. And it's really a great blessing if you can have in your parishes services for the Nativity Forefeast every night of the Forefeast leading up to Christmas. And to teach your people that this is, that Christmas is a winter Pascha, as it's called. And in the service books it says, on Christmas Day it says Pascha. And so the week leading up to it is a winter Holy Week and should be kept that way. Leave taking of Christmas is the 31st of December. Then there's a 1 day long feast on January 1st, the circumcision of Christ, which is of course 8 days after his nativity. And then immediately on the 2nd, we begin the Theophany Forefeast. And Theophany has a 4 day long forefeast, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th of January. The feast itself is on the 6th, and the leave taking on the 14th. The next great feast is the Meeting of the Lord, February 2nd, leave-taking on the 9th. And then, around this time of year, now it's different every year, based on the date of Pascha, but around this time of year, we begin to use the Triodion. And we have the preparatory Sundays, as I mentioned, but then the Triodion gets in full swing on the week of Cheese Fair. And Cheese Fair week is really a unique week in the year, because it's kind of a transitional week from out of the period of the Octoechos into the period of the Triodion, and they're both used. So during the week of Cheese Fair, the week before Lent, we have the Octoechos and the Triodion and the Menaion. So it's actually one of the most, according to the rubrics, the directions, it's one of the most complicated weeks of the year, interestingly. Then Lent begins. At some point we have Annunciation, we've talked about that. When we get to Holy Week, notice what happens. For the first time in the entire year, the Menaion drops out. When we get to Lazarus Saturday, the day before Palm Sunday, we know we stop commemorating the saints of the day, according to the fixed date, and we focus entirely on Christ's journey to his passion and resurrection. And so Holy Week begins with Palm Sunday and takes us through Pascha. We switch to the Pentecostarion. We resume using the Menaion the day after Thomas Sunday, on Monday of Thomas Week. Although, as I said, this year we will actually use the Menaion on Thomas Sunday because of St. John the Theologian on May 8th. We go through the various weeks of Pascha. We get to Ascension, look, again, the Pentecostarion takes over, the Menaion drops out. So it's a great feast, it's all about that feast. Same thing on the Sunday of Pentecost, same thing on the Sunday of All Saints. The day after All Saints, Monday, we begin to use the Octoechos again. So the green reappears here, and the Apostles' Fast begins. The Apostles' Fast begins on Monday after All Saints, and it takes us up to the Feast of Peter and Paul at the end of the month on June 29th. There's another very important feast in June, and that's the Nativity of St. John the Baptist, the forerunner, on June 24th. And that date, of course, is connected to the date of Christmas on December 25th. because the gospel tells us that St. John was born 6 months before Christ and was conceived 6 months before Christ. So this marks basically halfway till the next Christmas. July doesn't actually have any great feasts in it. It does have some important saints' days, like the feast of the prophet Elijah on July 20th, St. Seraphim of Sara on July 19th, St. John of San Francisco on July 2nd, but no great feasts. August, the 1st of August is a feast of the procession of the cross, which is a feast that a lot of people don't know about. But it's similar to the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross, but it's not one of the 12 great feasts. And it's the first day of the Dormition Fast, the 2-week fast at the beginning of August that takes us through Dormition, sometimes called the Fast of the Mother of God. But just like the Nativity Fast and like the Apostles' Fast, there's not a special book of hymns for this fast, like there is for the Triodion. Most of the Dormition Fast is taken up with the Feast of the Ascent of the Transfiguration of Christ, August 6th, with the four feasts on the 5th and the leave-taking on the 13th. And then the very next day, we have the four feasts of Dormition on the 14th, the feast on the 15th, the leave-taking on the 23rd. And finally, the last important feast of the year, so to speak, they're all important, but you know what I mean, is the 29th of August, the beheading of St. John the Baptist. So there again, we see an example of where the Menaion takes over and the Octoechos drops out. So, I've given you a great deal, a kind of big overview with a lot of details. I hope you're not too overwhelmed, but I think I hope that I've given you a good foundation, and we're going to build on this next time, next month. We're going to take a look at one particular service, a Vespers service for probably a Saturday night, and we're going to see how the church uses these books together and how they're combined to put together the entire service. So we'll get a very specific example of all of this in action. So any closing comments or questions? Yes?
How exactly are the fasts connected to, well, one of the fasts connected to the books and cycles? Because I understand that the Nativity and the Dormition fast would be connected to the Menaion because they are fixed days.
Correct.
Then with Great Lent, I understand that it would probably be the Triodion.
Yes.
And what about the Apostles' Fast? What is that connected to exactly?
Well, the Apostles' Fast is the only fast that has a variable length each
year.
Yes. Because the beginning of the Apostles' Fast depends on the date of Pascha, and is the day after All Saints. But the end of the Apostles' Fast is fixed, being the day of Peter and Paul, the apostles. So it's called the Apostles' Fast because it's leading up to the Feast of the Apostles Peter and Paul on June 29th. And it is actually, I believe, the second oldest fast that we have. Great Lent is the oldest fast. The Apostles' Fast is a very ancient fast. We took it from Rome, which is, of course, the city of Peter and Paul, where they were martyred. And it's a fast that commemorates their martyrdom, and it's a fast that commemorates the apostolic labors that that all the apostles went through. Most of them ending their lives as martyrs. So essentially, the Apostles' Fast is our response to Pentecost.
Okay.
So on Pentecost, we celebrate the descent of the Holy Spirit, which sends the apostles out and sends us out as proclaimers of the gospel of Christ. But we cannot proclaim the gospel of Christ without having asceticism. We have to have self-control. We have to curb our passions in order to be apostles. All Saints, the week after Pentecost, shows us the action of the Holy Spirit in his people. So All Saints shows us what the Holy Spirit does. He makes saints, of whom the apostles are preeminent. because the apostles are not only martyrs, but they are leaders of the church. They are those who knew Christ personally while he walked on earth. So the apostles' fast is the fast of our missionary work as saints in the church today. It's a very important fast. On the new calendar, we won't have an apostles' fast this year because Pascha is so late. This is one of the problems with having the new calendar for the Menaion and the old calendar for Pascha. But we should be very careful to observe the apostles' fast in most of the years when it does occur, because this is a great time for our prayer for the expansion of the church and for our zeal for proclamation of Christ's gospel and for our readying for the possibility of a martyric end, which, as our culture deteriorates, becomes seemingly more and more likely for many Christians. And of course, today we see many martyrs in some parts of the world already. I think I should end there.